frankly, further along on that continuum than others. And so states that don't get in, we will absolutely give written, precise feedback, individual feedback to each state, and we hope they come back stronger the next time. And if they get in, great. If not, we hope they come back even stronger the third time. And so this is something we're in it for the long haul. We want to be a good partner, and we want to make sure that everyone continues to grow and work together.
Governor Granholm, then Governor Perdue.
I echo what everybody has said. You guys have been just so unbelievable. It's amazing what the promise of some funding of resources does to cause people to change. I'm on the issue of the lowest performing schools. And in line with what Jim just asked, for those, we know that there are models out there that work, right? And charters as well as traditional schools. And I know a lot of that is coming by formula, if I'm not mistaken. But it would be, and maybe you're already doing this, but I think that to put out there specifically what you would like to see happen based upon the best practices that you know are out there, like we know in many low-performing schools, increasing seat time and length of year, et cetera, as you've described, and you know the merit pay for teachers who go to those tougher districts, if those are the formula that you'd like to see, to be very specific about it, because we will absolutely do it if we have clear guidance about what works, and y'all are the experts, and I just have to convince, you know, the legislature or whomever that this is what they want, and we will get the funding, and it will happen. The clarity would be really, really terrific.
Right. So the great point. So just to reiterate what I said before, that on the school improvement grants of $3.5 billion, every state is going to get their proportional share by formula. So that's going to go out. That's not a competition. What we're asking for you is then to compete it out at the local level. And again, not every district is going to be ready for that kind of change, and we want you to be very selective and very smart. And again, we're giving you a couple years to do this so that we can ramp up over time. There's no magic bullet. This is tough, tough, tough work. There's a reason why this hasn't happened in the country. It's because it's so tough and so hard and often controversial. There are a couple things that we think are important. We'll try and, again, as a country, start to learn from each other. So we'll have our first turnarounds at scale this year. We hope many will be phenomenal. Some, frankly, will fail, and we know that. We're not going to be 100% successful. We'll learn from both the success and failures. But I would argue at the end of the day, and we'll continue to track this very closely, to evaluate it and really see which practices that are emerging are the best. I continue to go back to just talent matters tremendously, and how you get underserved communities the best teachers and the best principals is a huge, huge deal. And historically in education, there have been very few incentives and lots of disincentives to get the best talent where you need it most. And so we're trying to fundamentally turn that around, and that's easier said than done. And then secondly, I just think, to your point, we have to work hard. We need more, this, I have to get booed when I talk to students about this, but our days are too short, our weeks are too short, our years are too short. I said, we don't need another study about summer reading loss. We get kids to a certain point in June, and kids from disadvantaged communities too often come back to school in the fall further behind than when they left. Why do we perpetuate that? Why do we permit that to happen? So at a time of scarce resources, can you lengthen the school day for every child? Of course not. But can you lengthen the school day for those children that are desperately trying to catch up? And it's fascinating when you look at the data. Children who come to school behind in our country nationally actually improve at a pretty good pace. The problem is they never catch up to children that come from more middle class, more advantaged communities. And so while they're learning, that gap never closes. So if we're going to close the gap, we have to do things differently. So whether it's 11 months a year, whether it's 6 months a day, whether it's 8 or 9 hours a day, those are the kinds of things that have to happen. So thinking about talent, thinking about time, and thinking about innovative ways to engage children and families where it hasn't happened before. Many children in low-performing schools, their parents went to the same schools. Their parents struggled in school. School is difficult for them. Often parents aren't really included. How do you rally the entire community? We haven't talked about Promised Neighborhoods Initiative, but schools often can't do this by themselves. How do you get the entire community rallying behind that? And so we will do everything we can to share best practices, to share what's not working. And again, there's nothing proprietary here. We want to be absolutely transparent, evaluate each year, and I hope the turnarounds we do 4 years from now as a country are that much better than the ones we do this fall because of our collective learning.
Governor Perdue.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary, and you've literally changed the conversation around education in this country, and I applaud you for that as well. I think while you may not have spent any money yet, we've been chasing that $4 billion lure pretty good. And I think I'm with Governor Doyle. We plan to get a share of it. But obviously, as governors, we know that education is intimately involved with economic development and the future prosperity of our states as well as our nation. So I think we're focusing exactly on the right thing. And I was one of the governors who was at times vocally critical of No Child Left Behind, although I also recognize it called the accountability question. And frankly, to our shame as a nation, we had never called the accountability question in education. In fact, most of our strategies had been to remediate those that failed and never ask any more. So I applaud the expecting high standards, high expectations, and rewarding excellence. And so I think the fact is, in education historically, we'd been like a Lake Wobegon, where we just expected all of our kids to be above average. And the fact that we're the data portion, where we're keeping score, and when we're expecting more, and when we're helping those that that want to be helped, and when we're changing the course for those that refuse to be helped, I think what you're doing with giving us the flexibility will take the accountability issue over to the high standards and the expectation that we as governors applaud. Florida, Kentucky, Georgia to some degree were some of those early states that had the accountability portion, but we had never asked that question as a nation. So I remember my excitement last year when you laid out your vision, and you have done exactly where you said you were going. And my encouragement to you is thank you for what you're doing, and you've got all the help I can give to stay the course, because you're exactly right down where we should be as a nation. And I think you will literally change the future prosperity of our nation by these high expectations and high standards and educating and innovating ourselves into future prosperity. So thank you on that.
Thank you. One thing if I could add, and I'm going to turn it to Carmel to elaborate, is as you guys know, as we raise standards, you're going to see results actually go down.
That's right.
And that's going to be a tough thing for folks to understand and to comprehend in states where today 90% of students are meeting some dummy down standard, might go to 30% or 20%. And so we need to work with you of how we articulate that to the public, and again, how we don't hurt you for doing the right thing, but actually reward you for doing the right thing. A big thing, and I want, Carmen, if you can sort of walk us through, is thinking about growth and gain and how much are people improving each year and not just an absolute number. And Carmen, can you sort of just take a minute and sort of walk through how we're trying to change the conversation around that?
Sure. I'd say there's two ways we're looking to do that, is by letting the accountability system be the foundation of the accountability system be founded on this concept of growth. So it's not just whether a student is where they're supposed to be in terms of proficiency, but whether they've made enough progress that they either got where they needed to be or that you have faith they can catch up. So, you know, if a teacher or if a school takes a fifth grade student who comes in at the first grade level and they get that student to the third grade level, that's not a bad school, that's not a bad teacher, that's actually an exceptional school, an exceptional teacher. So allowing for that kind of analysis to be part of the accountability system. And then the second is with respect to schools and districts, looking at progress and trends over time. So allowing you to look at, in identifying the bottom 5% of schools, we're asking you not just to look at what schools are at the bottom of your performance trajectory in terms of absolute performance, but which ones haven't made any progress over time. And likewise, in terms of the reward system that the Secretary mentioned earlier that we're proposing there, it wouldn't just be rewarding schools that have 90% of their children's proficient, particularly schools that, you know, the students started at a high level, but rather rewarding schools that took high poverty student populations and helped them to move towards proficiency at higher than expected rates. So those are the types of schools that we want to give rewards to.
So this is a point where the chair gets to shamelessly promote their own state. We put in place a growth model that's a web-based growth model, www.schoolview.org. Any public school in the state, you go in, you can bring that school up, you can see where it falls on the sort of the graph of high-performing, high-achieving, low-performing, low-achieving, or somewhere in between on performance and achievement, then you can go inside the school and you can look at teachers. We passed a teacher identification number so you can see how students do in that classroom along a continuum if they're growing and